So what I'm going to talk about today, that what does the tomorrow of today look like? When we look at, there's a lot of talk which is going on in terms of evolution, revolution, and as I was just chatting about with Sundar, and I would just borrow a line from Sundar, which says that typically science, when you look at, science talks about, science doesn't basically in theory believe in invention. It only and only says evolution. How do you go about evolution and adoption? And that's true in every phase. So when we say about tomorrow of today, how does it look like if we look at? And I would like to start with one line which says, nobody is ever ready or less ready for tomorrow than the person who holds the most toughest belief about it. It's about that typically we have a lot of these conventions and a lot of these thoughts that how does the tomorrow will look like. And when we start thinking about it and when we start preparing for tomorrow, that's exactly the point when you are completely not prepared. Because that is the time in point or case in point when you are thinking basis your historical beliefs about tomorrow. It's about what you feel the tomorrow will hold. Let's look at what we feel at Hero. What are these disruptive trends are going to be and how does these trends are going to impact the overall tech as well as overall humanity. At the end of the day, technology is about driving the lifestyle. Technology is about driving humanity. Technology is all about to enable the conversations and technology is all about to enable the simple living. It needs to make the life more simple. If you look at the socio-economic trends, if I was to look at it, today, the brands have changed. It's no more the same brands. It's about what the experience you are delivering in a brand versus the product. And that is where when I look at Hero, when you look at the overall Hero group, we are completely changing the scenario, whereas we are one of our group companies, which is Hero Cycles in India, Evoset in UK, which is most of you would have heard about brands like Riddle, or in India, you would have heard about Firefox, which is again a Hero company. When you look at these organizations, we do not talk about product. We talk about the experience. We talk about the joy of cycling. We talk about the networking over cycling. We talk about the grouping which you make when you cycle on. We talk about the gangs which you form when you cycle. And that is what the thing is. So when we look at, it's about the consumer experience which the brands need to drive more than talk about their own products. It's no more about the brand. It's no more about my story. It's about the story of a person who is going to use the brand. It's about story of his life and not about my life. And this is very, very true because of your, in today's world, your brand needs to deliver the product and service which can actually change or impact the lifestyle of consumer and help him in deciding his own workflow. It's not about how I perceive my product. It's all about how consumers are looking at your product and how they are going to use the product in their everyday lifestyle. If I look at it is about all about that relevance for moment of truth. It is no more. So when I talk about one of my previous brands, which is Nokia, I would like to draw one thing, which is when Nokia in about 2008 was holding a market share of 78%. All of you who would have traveled at that point in time would remember that the moment the flight lands, the only sound you can hear in an aircraft was ting, 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 and that two hands coming together. 2012, just about 4 years. I don't need to mention what happened. Because of we were not, or somewhere we lost out the moment of truth for customer. Somewhere we got too focused about Symbian. Somewhere we got something focused, eBay. I don't need to mention more than that. And that's where the marketing today, it's the need to become the marketing needs to change from sharing narratives to become to delivering the consumer experience. It's all about that. And that's where when we look at the Hero, what we are doing, we are no more talking about products. We are no more talking about that what how many gears the bicycle has. We do not talk about how many kilometers your pedal will run. We talk about that how is it going to help you? And with that, we are, in fact, putting up the one of the largest cycling network in the world. We happen to be the largest at this point in time, and I'm proud to share that any cycle in the world which sells, every fifth cycle which is selling in the world is from the Group Hero. And we have about 23 different brands under the umbrella of the Group HMC, which is called as Hero Motors Company. And we are not only in cycling. You would be surprised to know, Ducati, everybody knows Ducati? Anywhere you buy Ducati in the world, 93% chances are that the transmission system of Ducati is being made by Hero. Any Ducati you buy in the world, 93%. BMWs, we use it. Any BMW you buy in India, it is coming from Hero. The entire chassis is being made by Hero. It's not made by BMW. Any car you drive today, the rear wheel of the car, the rear drum brakes and knuckles are from Hero Group. We have about 90% plus market share in that. So these are all the things. But do we talk about it? The experience, all about the joy of cycling. And that's where it is. So we need to zero in the needs. And that's what the change which is happening. And this change has been brought in multiply by the way lifestyle. The millennials are the one which are driving the change. Today, the second largest thing which is happening. We talk about sharing economy. But what we feel at Hero, the sharing economy is a thing of past. It's about an on-demand economy. While people do feel and we keep looking at sharing is what P2P happens. It's about a person-to-person sharing, in which you have to wait, you have to schedule, you have to plan. How many of us do rides in advance? Just if you look at ride share, how many of you use Ride Now and how many of you use, like, Book It in advance? If you know that it will be available. If you are not sure that it will not come in time, you typically just click Ride Now. You don't wait. There is nobody who is going to wait for it. And that's what the on-demand economy we talk about. Every transaction today is becoming on-demand. It's about when do I need it? How do I need it? Where do I need it? Everything is going on the Uber, on Airbnb. That's where. And we look at Airbnb, and we are putting up, again, the one of the largest public bike sharing platform. There are in spritz which are coming up, so anybody who is interested in cycling will be noticing that today you can cycle around anywhere. Yes, there is an infrastructure support which is required. Yes, there is a public, the lifestyle changes which are required. But those are the things which are happening in different pockets in the country. And I'm talking about India right now, I'm not talking about outside. In India itself, you have multiple public bike sharing platforms, and the things which are happening now is these platforms are converging faster than you think any other convergence. And what the user needs is a transparency, which is very, very, very basic requirement by the user. We are in a world of digital overdose. We actually are in a world of digital overdose. There's so much of it which is happening. If you look at yourself, if you look at our own lifestyle, emails, apps, notifications, every time this small device is kind of choking us on our bandwidth. There's so much of information which is flowing into us that tough. And that's true for consumer also. When we as a marketer decide to push our message to consumer, do we actually look at how many messages is he getting? Do we actually consider we are concerned about, has our Facebook ad delivered? How much conversation do I have been able to generate? What is my open ratio in an email? How am I able, what is it that, how many people are actually interacting with my bots? How many people are coming and logging into my website? What's the bounce? And blah, 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 blah. But are we actually looking at the consumer? Is he only using it for this? How many of us are actually looking at from that point? Look at, and this actually is requiring, and that's why you look at the advent of what we call it filters. Consumers are actually putting up filters. If you look at your own phones, anybody, typically an average, has about 30 plus apps. How many of us do we actually open? How many of apps you are opening on a daily basis? How much time are you spending on that app in that moment? How many of us actually ourselves go and look at a complete video at the Facebook or a YouTube? We are a consumer as well as marketer. And that actually requires, as marketers, we need to require that how do we create a content and the story which fits up to the user narrative. If it is a user narrative, then only the user is going to look at it. Otherwise, we can just keep looking at it and keep wondering that where is that click coming from and where is that view coming from. If we look at the overall, the fourth thing which is happening, it's about digital transformation. A lot of people are talking about, everybody from 8x8 shop owner to a 8,000x8,000 big business owner, everybody is talking about digital transformation. And yes, businesses are getting empathetic, and there is a lot of experimentation which is happening in that. However, having said that, there is a need for realignment and investment in technology and business model. It's not about putting up one website, it's not about making an app, it's not about creating a platform for your company. It's all about how my business narrative is going to fit in to the overall business model. What is the changes which we require in the business model? And when we look at the hero perspective, when we were thinking about changing and aligning ourselves to the current narrative, we said we are the largest manufacturer of bikes. What happens if people start using the public bike sharing? Then you don't need to buy, because of you have a bike anywhere available in the world. You just walk out of your home, you have a public bike sharing stand, just pick up a bike from there, ride onto it, take it anywhere in the world, dump it there, move on. And there is somebody who's going to take care of. But what happens to us in that entire journey? Where is those people when I look at that every fifth person who's going to buy it from the house of hero? How does it happen to me? But can we stop that? Could we actually, if we do not participate, could we stop that? Would the user not do this? If not us, somebody would. And that's when we actually realized, we created a company which is known as Hexi. We are in partnership with Yuan Bikes, which is the largest bike sharing platform from China. Again, supporting OFO. And OFO is the largest bike sharing company, which has about 80 million bikes anywhere in the world. At any point in time, they are riding about, as I am saying that, they would have done about 1,000 odd miles anywhere on their bikes would have happened by the time I have told about it. And we are the one who are supporting it at this point in time, that company. It means that we need to realign our entire business model. The business need not to be the technology center. The technology need to support the human life and the way humans want to drive their life, and the way they need to drive their transactions, and the way they need to drive their conversations, and the way they need to drive their networks, and your technology need to come and support that entire, and the business cases need to be rewritten to support that entire transactional and the relationships. If we look at consumer journey, it's no more lateral consumer journey, it's no more linear. You can't say that consumer are going to come to my shop, to my website, and then we'll speak to my call center, then we'll make payment, and then they will take a demo, and then they will experience the product. It could be anywhere. It's all haphazard. Nobody knows. Different consumers can take different paths to transact, and different paths can lead to different kind of a consumer segments to transact. It's completely non-linear and completely decentralized. It's not central to a brand. You cannot decide putting up, just because of you are there on Amazon, you cannot guarantee that even if you have bought the entire media of Amazon, that your product is going to take shape the way you want. It is about the way consumer want. And that's the reason why, in fact, if you look at, these are statistics from Google, whereas they say that 90% of people, when they are thinking about something, they are completely not certain about what they want to buy. Which brand do they want to transact? And about 65% people will look multiple sources before they can decide what brand they want. And it is not about your story. They are not going to look at what you are only going to say, and you cannot hold back the information. It is not only true in brands, it's not only true in sales. How many people would have fathomed that people are going to give their information about what has happened when they went for an interview? Look at today, Naukri.com. Look at today, all these job platforms. Why do they have people sharing about their interview knowledge? These are the platforms which only thrives because of, we don't pay for them. It's the employer who's paying them, and they are actually putting employer in open naked, that this is the employer who is actually talking like that. They are the one, if you look at, again, if you go on the platform, you will see that today, you have a consultant's information being available openly on Naukri. Why did they choose to do that? At the end of the day, as a prospective employee or as a prospective recruiter, if you know, or recruitee or job, if you know that who's the guy who's working on it, you can just dump the platform and go and directly connect with the employer. But still they are doing it because they know very well, if they do not do it, there is somebody who is going to do it. And it is true in every sense. So when somebody next time comes to us, and that's the reason why we are coming up a platform, again, back in Hero, our entire digital footprints are changing, and we are coming up, day after tomorrow, we are coming up with the new digital footprints, where you will have the information about everything what goes in a bike. From the kind of a very, very lubricant we are putting up, to the kind of a latex which is going, to the kind of a steel which is going, to the kind of a paint which is going, everything. And it was a big, big call which we took. Because when we were discussing about it, there was so much of resistance. It's about I'm sorry, Sundar, I'm borrowing. He mentioned that it's a one Indianized cult brand. It's an Indianized cult when you say Hero, Desh Ki Dhadkan. When you look at that kind of a brand, which has a legacy of about 70 odd years, it is a brand which has started much before the independence happened. It was a brand which was there in 1942, set up by four brothers who were migrated from Kamalia in Pakistan. They just migrated to Amritsar, started as a component manufacturer, and this is what today Hero is. When we started looking at it internally, whereas our average age group is more than 42, 44 years, there are people who are working with us for almost 30 odd years. They came in as an apprentice and till date they are there. When you go and ask them that give this information, there are so many questions coming up and saying, what if we put this entire thing up? There are people who are going to just copy us. What if we don't put it, somebody else do that? And then they are going to do that. How many of you can stop that? Is the information not available? Today your IPR is not what you have created. Your IPR is what consumers feel, that differentiation in the experience which you bring. It's not about your production process, but it's about the consumption process which you aid when a consumer rides. Saddle. It's not about the paint, which the way you paint it, the way you spray it. It's the way the consumer takes it to a trail and yet not paint chip off. It's not about the way you put up the lubrication in the chain. It's about when a consumer drives it and he feels that the velocity is much higher, the effort taken is much lesser. And this is what Hero brings into you. If we look at the, is Shiny there? Shiny. Can I have some water? I'm sorry. If we look at the overall work, when we are actually, thank you. I'm sorry. If we look at the overall, our work culture, how many of millennials do you feel you can go up when in our age and we consider, for example, my birthday cake costs less than the candles which I put it onto it, so I'm as old as that. And when you look at today, the millennials who are like 18 years, 19 years, and those are the guys who are joining the workforce. If you look at that workforce today, how many of them you can go and say that these are your years to slog? These are your years that you compromise on everything. And how many will get back to you and say, yes, I'm going to compromise till 12 o'clock in night or 1 a.m. in the morning and then again be back at 7 a.m. in the office? I think if you do that, you will have the answers. I am working because I want to have a life and not the other ways around. And that's the answer which you will get. Their entire lifestyle, the new workforce is different. The new working category is different. The new consumer is different. And these guys are going to join your workforce. And these are the guys who are making the consumers for today. So when you look at that, we will, at the end of the day, humans will pick up what they do the most of the times. They are not going, it's not that some as an employee I behave differently and as a consumer I behave differently. My habits remain same. At the end of the day, I'm the same human inside, whether it's at the workplace or at my own friend's place. Yes, my certain vocabulary can change, the way I talk can change, the way I address can change, but the central message will not. And hence, when these guys who have the access to the mobile, to the technology, when they were first opening their eyes, they expect the world to behave in the same way. Your workplace needs to become what your IT devices are, what your appification is. Your communication, your applications, which are your work applications, need to mimic the real world work application. And that's the reason when you ask them, you haven't sent a mail, and they'll say, I just informed you over a WhatsApp. What's the big deal in mail? I sent you a WhatsApp. Why did you not approve it? Because of that's what they expect. And if that's the expectation, then again, the overall organizations need to change and realign their entire culture to the new workforce. And at Hero, what we have done for that. So for example, some of our work groups, again, we are making them mail free. There's a complete, and again, mind you, 70 years old company, and I'll give you a real life example. Some time back, when we put up one of our analytics software, and we sent out a bill for that, we were putting up an analytics platform, and we sent out a bill, and it was a very, very small application. You know the kind of a question I got from the accounts department? And this is a real world example. My accounts guy, who is somewhere just about to retire, and I think in like a couple of months he'll retire, he called me up and said, I've got a bill, but there is no support to the bill. I said, what support do you require? He said, isme delivery kidhar hua hai? Saman aaya nahi hai, to store se ispe stamp nahi laga hai. No store guy has put up a stamp onto the bill that he has received the material. I said, but it's a service. How do you put up a... No, sir. Here, if it was a service, then this has to be service contract. You have bought it. So there has to be something which has to get into an inward store. And that's when we realized, we started looking at our entire workflow, and we realized that it was written in the process, and this guy was very sweet following the process, that you have bought, you have raised a PO, PO need to come back, has to get into a store, the SCM need to verify that this has come in, the post-service and the post-production and things like that has to happen because that is what he has done for 60 years of his life. And then there is one more guy in the team who is just about 20, just completed his young grad, and she is just kind of a joined the organization. She has never seen what a store is. And these are the two guys who are trying to work together. You have five different generations working in the same workplace. The only thing which you require is to look at your entire workplace from bottoms up. And that is what I think is going to change. And if it does not change, then there is a next Nokia waiting. Again, iRobot. How many of us could have fathomed? And I have one thing which I would like to draw your attention. How many of you have seen a movie called as Minority Report? Yeah? Certain hands out there, awesome. Does anybody remember what was the year shown in Minority Report? When they were showing the entire movie, does anybody remember the year written in that movie? Yeah? No? It was 2050. 2050 was the year. You know what this means? Remember? What does this mean? Yeah, this was kind of a, in a 3D world, you are kind of interacting with your system. Remember? If you haven't seen that, watch that movie, my humble recommendation is go and watch. It's a beautiful movie. Only thing is, it is redundant. What they have told you about 2050, 70% of that has already happened in 2015. And this movie came in the year, I think, 1999. In 1999, somebody sat down and thought that this evolution will take 51 years to happen. And this did not even took the first Naveen Mistry. How many of you have heard about the name? Sixth Sense Naveen Mistry. Yeah? Awesome. If you haven't, please go and do a Google for them. And if anybody from Google, you can pay a royalty for promoting. Yeah? This guy developed the interaction platform between the real world and the software world, 2006. And would you guess what was the basics he used to develop that? the simple mouse, the humble mouse, which we have, all of us have at our homes and our computers. So this is the speed. And with that speed, if you look at robotics, automation is going to happen whether you like it or not. You know, there was an article about a couple of years back. Morgan Stanley as a bank had about, in their UK office, they have about, a couple of years back, they had about 600 odd guys in their stock broking house who used to kind of buy and sell stocks. They went on automation. Guess how many guys would have been there today? Any guess? While 600 guys only put up to work on stock market. Any guesses how many guys remaining? Just take a wild guess. Six? You have read the story or it was a wild guess? You just thought zeros are useless. And you know who these six guys are? There are about six odd guys from the broking and there are about 15 odd guys from a software programming. They do not need it because they have automated the entire platform, which is much more predictable. These guys do not go for a coffee break, and these guys do not go, they do not get fights, they do not have upswings of the moods or downswings of the moods, and they are working right like a clock. Your lot of jobs are going to get redundant. Trust me, friends. Whatever can be automated will be automated. Anything which requires a basic amount of thinking even is going to get automated. Yours and my job are going to automate it. Don't you feel better when you speak, even you chat about or speak or put up a complaint about and it gets immediately logged in, replied immediately and closed immediately and somebody is signed. You feel nice. But till the time humans you put it, humans will have a human behavior coming in and hence people are going to automate it. So whether you like it or not, that's the future which is coming in. Now, how do you prepare your own organization to be able to combat that, to be able to beat that? For example, today, my per-person productivity is at about every minute I produce about 25 odd bicycles, and every person in my organization produces about 14 odd bicycles per day. That's my per-person productivity. Next year, I will be having the capacity doubled and workforce half. So you will have about 27.5 bicycles being produced by one person every day. In a much more efficient way, in a much better manner, and these bikes are going to be much better than what they were. And these are all technology which is driving it. Welcome to the future, which is today. The corporate presence. You have to see that, how the corporates are going to. As I said, there are new business models which are emerging in. We need to be there, we need to participate in those business models. The marketing and IT is no more the difference. How many marketing people today at any level can afford to say that I do not know how a website works? I do not know how a technology will drive. I do not know the software. Can anybody afford to say that? If you are not marketing, say, Opium or a Hashish, in fact, these guys will also, they are much better because they need to go on the kind of the black web and things like that and figure out people. Trust you me, even if you are Al-Qaeda, you need somebody in a digital team to be able to kind of carry your message. Isn't that? Think about it. The terrorists need digital. The businesses need digital. The black businesses need digital. The white businesses need digital. So there's a future which is lying. And I'm very excited. The reason why I always take Al-Qaeda name, I'm just wondering, how will their boss would have been saying, there are 5 bomb blasts going to happen, and you will upload, and I will come and check how many views has happened. Think about it. They can develop an IoT platform. How many bombs have I planned? Okay, too much of creative thinking. Coming back, they can even have a CRM. Whereas they can put up which all victims, I will track them online, and that's where I will go and bounce them. This is the future, if you come to think of it. Nobody would have thought some 30 years back that people like that, businesses like that, organizations like that will need to talk and communicate. Would somebody think that they will need to communicate if they are going to do a murder, they are going to do a blast, they are going to sell something, OPM or something like that? But these guys are talking much more than we guys are. How does businesses look into that kind of a convergence? If we look at R&D, one of the most talked about, and sorry, I have only about, so I'll rush from here. R&D are becoming the corporate innovation centers. You do not need a research, you need innovations today. You need to, because of research is what you had in history and how do you multiply on it, and innovation is completely different. You need to scratch from zero and create it, and that is what today's consumer demand. Corporations, organizations, individuals need to understand the need to fail first and fail fast. And that is the philosophy at the ground level which we hero at follow. If you got to fail, be the first one to fail and do it now. Don't delay it. Just fail it. Keep failing, keep failing, keep failing till the time you build up on failure so much that you can succeed. Till the time you do 100 things, make 99 fail. But make that one thing which counts for the failure of 99. And this is the emergence of culture 2.0. And this cannot happen by the time your C-suite culture supports it. You need to have that conversation with your exico, with your leaders, and they need to understand much more than anybody else that it is the time of engagement. It is not the time whereas you can have the wooden doors. In fact, you have to get into a way to remove all the doors between the exico and the consumer. Leave aside your last mile employee. And what we do at Hero for that is, we have created platforms whereas people can directly speak to CMDs. You don't need anybody else. You need no appointment, you need nothing, just walk up and speak to him. And say, this is what I think. And if you have a thought, which, whatever it could be, but every thought has to get through a complete process of evolution. Whatever you say, if you believe in what we say, then go ahead and just do it. Fail first, fail fast. And that brings in the need for radical transparency. As I said earlier, your IPR is not how you produce, your IPR is how it gets consumed. It's not about what you feel is transparency, but it's about what a consumer needs to see from you as transparency. If you look at the technology trend, and a lot of us are familiar to that, so I would kind of go there, chatbots, as I said. They are here. They are not something which is going to happen 5 years down the line. They are here, already here. And a lot of us are interacting with them. How you are going to be implementing them and how are you going to use them to simplify everything is what the key is. It's the age of mobile first. Need of mobile first. You cannot create a platform. You cannot create a business process. You cannot have a workflow which does not mimic the mobile first behavior. It's no more a website creation, it's no more an app creation. And by the way technology is moving and the way talks are happening all around is that apps are a thing of past already. While a lot of us are catching up on apps, look at the way future is moving. If you would have seen the IOs conferences and the developer conferences of the top leaders of technology, whether they are into social or they are into tech world, they are talking about voice. They are talking about your imitating your movements. Now, if you can imitate your movement, at the end of the day, you're this real estate which you hold, some 4x3 screen, which actually requires a small genset in your pocket somewhere, and a lot of us carry those. So earlier, if you remember, there was a mobile phone. It became small, small, small. Then it started becoming big, 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 big. Now you have a mobile phone which is sleek and big, and then you have a bigger something which is called as power bank. And you carry both of them. And then you have a kind of wire strapped around somewhere and you can use it like a belt. So whenever you forget that, you just tie it up. Because of any which ways, you have to have these two devices together. Trust me, friends, that this real estate is very costly. And people are going to innovate on this real estate. You cannot have a consumer giving you this real estate just like that. And I read it on this only, that people delete the app because they don't like the logo. Because of it has to match, it has to mimic the real world life of these guys. It's the machine age. It's the age everybody of us have heard about it. Quantum computing, pattern recognition, cognitive computing, common sense, the biggest. So the best part about technology is, if you are speaking to a technology, you know that the common sense will be common there. With humans, you might have a question out there that how much is it? Because of it will tell you what it has actually understood and how you have told it, how you have programmed it, and what it has learned. And these all are things are happening today. So think about a future where you can completely, the technology and the platforms are going to overtake your workflows. How is your organization ready for that? One of the biggest things which are going to happen, healthcare. We go to a doctor. How many of us have seen that most of the doctor clinics today, when you go and you are coming out, he'll just take your prescription and say, sir, ek bar isko de dijiye, thoda sa scan kar lete hain. You have seen that people are scanning your prescriptions? Do you actually feel, how many of you will feel comfortable if I ask for your prescription when you are coming out of a clinic? This was very, very private information. And you are giving it out to companies like Practo, who are digitalizing it, linking up with the public databases, and actually creating your health profile. Do not wonder that there are organizations which know much more about your health, much more about your lifestyle, much more about what you eat and what you think, than probably your life partners and your moms are. Because these are the guys who have actually used technology to define you as a human. Just to give you one thing, you know who has the maximum information about you? Maximum information about you in the world. Who, as whatever organizations you interact with, who will have? Quickly, anybody? By the way, people think bankers have the most information. Yeah? Because if they handle your most sensitive data, it's the telecom companies. Any telecom company puts up and dissects the consumer. Today, Jio dissects the consumer at 62,000 data points. Every consumer is mapped to those many number of data points. I've worked with one of the telecom companies, and I can tell you how much data points we use. To just look at one consumer, to just define one workflow, we exactly know that when you are going to talk, who you are going to talk, how long you are going to talk. Think about it, that's the data which you have already given out, and you have no control over it. And we talk about sharing our Aadhaar biometrics, whereas a dip is going to happen. You have a lot much data available. Today you use Google Homes. Am I right? I'm sorry. I should charge Google for that. You use Google Homes. Each one of us have that ready on our phones. Do you know that this is, if it can respond to commands, which means this is ready and listening to you? Is somewhere your profiling is happening, and it can listen to you at any point in time, whenever it wants. This is the Internet of Things. Again, a reality. How do you define it? There are too many products which are there right now. But as with every other evolution, this will also going to go the same way. You will have a convergence coming in. You will have the human algorithms taking over the software algorithms. And I need it now, I need it here, and I need it the way I want. And that is what the live streaming, mobile video, and now gives you. And that is what the change in ecosystem has happened. We have become more and more short-tempered. We do not want to wait. And that is what the technology enables you. You bring the niche movement, you bring the content, you bring the conversations on demand. And any of the organizations which will follow this route are going to go closer to consumers. So whenever next time when you are planning a communication, whenever next time you are planning a product, whenever next time you are planning a consumer experience, think about these three things, that how you can make it available when user wants it, the way he wants it, and where he wants it. Again, how many of us would have thought about it? And this is just one. It is not something which is happening tomorrow. It has already happened yesterday. How many of us have thought that we can have our own factories? Any one of you can become a producer today? No? Non-belief? Just put up a small 3D printer and you can have whatever you want to print. Why do you need big factories? And the more people start printing, the cheaper it is going to be. Then why do you need large corporations to make small things? Think about your own business. How many of us would have thought about it? Again, the same movie, which I was talking about, Minority Report. 2050, and this is 2017, you already have it. How many of us would have thought about that there could be a car possible where there is no driver? It's happening. Think about the number of jobs, think about the number of people, think about the consumer behavior, the way it is going to change. Your asset utilization goes multifold. And because of asset utilization goes multifold, the humans are taken out of it, which means it becomes much more cheaper to share. It becomes much more available for you, and it becomes much more demand-oriented, and it behaves the way you want it to behave. You have the Toyotas and Hondas of the world looking out for their next penny. It's a word of being real virtual, or virtually real, or really virtual, whatever way you want to say. And the RBIs and the bankers of the world. How many of us would have thought about it 4 years back, that you can have transactions happening in the world where government does not have a control, where the US, the big uncle, cannot actually control it, and nobody is monitoring it, and nobody knows who owns it, except you. And the last one. You cannot compete. You cannot. You can only change yourself to mimic what is happening. And with that, on that last one, it's the time for iteration, innovation, disruption. And do it to yourself before somebody gives it as a gift to you. Let's create the future. Thank you.